Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I'll talk about event handling, components, and the model view separation, all in the context of graphical user interface programming, GUI programming. So let's get started. So first of all, let's start with interactive computing. Up to now, you could consider a machine very simply as you give it a program, you give it some input, let it run, and you expect some output. But what happens if there is a user sitting behind the machine that is continuously interacting with it? So then the input is not just given at the start, the input is continuously given. That is also the case, for instance, while you are now watching this video. You could maybe hover with your mouse the video and stuff appears, or you could touch the screen and you pause this video. So there is a lot of interactivity going on. So what is now a good way of programming these interactive computing systems? Well, let's first of all start with event-based programming. Event-based programming is a certain paradigm that you can then use to structure your programs. Namely, consider that interaction can all be reduced to that you recognize certain events that happen. Whenever a user presses a key or clicks a mouse button or touches the screen at a certain position, these interactions all generate some event. Furthermore, you could think of elements on the screen, say, or audio or video playing also as generating events. So what the interactive computing system does is it takes as input a continuous stream of input events and it processes them, and as a result it generates a continuous stream of output events. So with this in mind, let's consider events and how to structure your programs to suit this particular paradigm. So you can think of a program as a process that takes input events and as a result reacts to those input events, potentially generating state changes, so its internal state is modified, or it generates output events that some underlying operating system can then use, for instance, to change the state of the screen by changing the color of pixels, or by changing the state of some audio device, thereby generating audio, etc. So to understand this, you can think of those events as objects. But those events can occur at any point while your program is executing. So it is typically the case that the events that are being generated, whether they are either caused by some user externally, these events are somehow put on a queue where you consider the events that still have to be processed. Now there is something that is called an event loop or an event dispatcher that is a piece of the program that repeatedly waits for an event to occur. Sometimes it is also the case that no event at all occurs, so it waits for the first event to occur and then starts processing such an event. Now, whenever an event is processed, this of course takes time. So in the meantime, additional events could be generated as well. So for instance, a user that is manically clicking on the mouse may generate a lot of events. And the program might be too slow to react to all those events. So all those events that are not yet processed are then inserted in the event queue. Eventually, the event loop will encounter those events later on and then reacts to it. So you might have sometimes encountered this on, say, a personal computer as well, that you are using a particular application and it no longer responds to your input. What is then going on? Well, most likely what is going on is that the program that specifies how the application should behave is still processing events in its event queue, and this takes up a lot of time, causing you to visually see that there is no response from the program. Then the program is too busy with dealing with processing with all the generated events. Now, it is also the case that as soon as an event from an external source, so as a user, for instance, has been added to the event queue, that during the processing of such an event, additional events are generated. You could call them internal events because they are generated by the program itself. And those are then also added to the event queue. So that then allows you to distinguish where do events come from. Are events triggered externally? So are they caused by some external stimulus, say a click of the mouse or say typing in a key? Or are they triggered by the processing of one of the events from the event queue? So to give you an example of an interactive computing system, let's consider a vending machine. And the vending machine has, say, some soda in it stored. Let's say it is represented by this global variable over here, how much bottles of soda it still contains. Now, there is a procedure that is the event handler, which then takes as an input argument some kind of event. And now the procedure inspects what kind of event that is. If it is an event that corresponds to the user pressing some button, that is then represented by this test. If E is the E is some kind of object, event is a class, and you could understand, for instance, button event as a subclass of event. Is it now the case that the object supplied to the event handler is indeed an instance of this subclass button event, and if the vending machine still has inventory, then you can say we'll subtract one from its inventory and then now trigger some kind of output event. And in this case, the serve event is constructed. It is then added to the event queue, and we assume that some kind of operating system communicating with the physical machine is then causing the soda bottle to be dispensed. Otherwise, if the event that could be triggered by the user, say some operator that then sees that the vending machine is out of inventory, it refills then the bottles and then presses a special button, or maybe when the lid closes after refilling, another event is generated and then corresponding action is taken. For instance, by resetting the global variable to some value, in this case 5. So this is just handling the events, and it is a particular part of the program. A different part of the program should drive the event loop. And the event loop typically has a structure that looks like this. It is a loop that indefinitely runs, so the program is not expected to terminate. It really represents a process here. In that process, we repeatedly wait for an event to occur. And if there is no event, then the call to poll will just wait until an event occurs. And then it takes the head of the queue, the event queue, which then in this case is E, which it then handles. Now, as you can see, if this was a button event that was somehow generated by the machine itself, then we can trigger a new event. And the trigger will then cause an event to be added to, say, the end of the queue. So this just gives you an overview a little bit of what event-based programming looks like. So you have on the one hand event handlers that handle particular events corresponding to actions that have happened as an input. And on the other hand, you might have actions that are supposed to represent an output of the machine. And furthermore, you can understand the operation of the machine as indefinitely executing an event loop. So it will never terminate. And in this event loop, it will repeatedly take off the event queue, the head of the queue, and then process such event. Okay, so that is a vending machine. of course, a real vending machine is way more complicated than this, but this gives you a bit of an idea. Let's consider now ways of programming using events, but in a more structured way. Because those events, you can imagine, at some point the machine might have hundreds or maybe thousands of possible inputs that occur. And if each of those inputs correspond to some event, we have a huge event handler. And that is all in a single place, very difficult to oversee precisely how these events all are related to each other. So it might be a good idea to structure your program then in a different way. And historically, this is also what happened. At some point, programs got a lot more complicated than what you see in this simple example. So not only an event loop and an event handler, but it turns out that sometimes you want to make reuse of the way certain events are processed. And for that, you can introduce a structure by considering components. Just like we had before the notion of objects, that was a way of understanding the way that the memory of a computer could be abstracted, so that the memory location was abstracted away so that you could put all the data and the methods you could use to operate on that data in a single place, a class. We can understand components as special kinds of classes which furthermore allow you to do event processing. So a component is a way to solve the issue that I described just before. So where you have a single event loop and then the event handler that handles all the possible events that could occur. It is not very modular because you could not make use of standard components, say, because lots of computing, interactive computing systems make use of lots of similar components that you may want to reuse and that you want to modularly put them together so that you can quickly and rapidly build interactive systems. Furthermore, if you want to extend the functioning of a machine, you have to dive into this huge event handler and tweak with it. So that makes it more difficult to extend, especially if you work together in large teams. So a common way of separating all those different components out of each other is precisely that. By adding to the notion of what an object is, the capability of letting each object handle and delegating events, you arrive at the notion of a component. And you can therefore understand a component to be more than an object. An object is a representation of some state. The fields of an object represented the memory contents and then the methods of the object, of the class of the object, would then be used to manipulate the object in place. Now, a component furthermore allows you to have an event handler per object. So it is indeed the case that typically components, as I described them here in the context of graphical user interfaces, are making use of a lot of object-oriented notions. So in that case, you can think of a component to be defined by a corresponding class. And also, just like we have in object-oriented programming a class hierarchy, you can understand in GUI programming there exists also a class hierarchy. And we will see some example components later on in a concrete example. Now, it's important to, from a visual perspective, understand that the components intuitively represent a region on the screen, right? If at least from the perspective of graphical user interfaces. So you could imagine that if you, for instance, use a desktop, that all the little buttons and lists and maybe scroll bars or maybe application decoration. It's just that you have a window which represents an application with a title where the application name is written. That all these are components. And the most intuitive way of understanding components is visually on the screen. So then the root most component, so to say, in components are put in a hierarchy, and the top of the hierarchy is the overall screen. And then for subregions of the screen, you could understand those to be managed by subcomponents. And those subcomponents fall underneath a parent. And the parent then manages their children component. And this forms then say a family tree. And there's a hierarchy of the components that fall all the way on the top that have access to the whole screen. And then you have components that maybe are responsible for only a few pixels, say a very small button as part of, say, a scroll bar. So this hierarchy is intuitively clear if you look from components from a graphical perspective. It is also quite nice that if you put components in such a hierarchy, that then the event processing is also streamlined according to such a hierarchy. So that means that, for instance, the events that the input events, say you have a mouse pointer that moves around the screen, that the rootmost component representing the overall screen receives all those events. And then the root component delegates the events to its subcomponents whenever the mouse is also hovering such subcomponents. And then it is the case, for instance, if you consider, say, a button, that you don't necessarily have sufficient. If you always keep on the low-level input events, like clicking here or moving the mouse over there, this might not represent the semantics of a graphical user interface application. So it is often the case that components also define their own higher-level events. Say an event representing that the user has clicked a button. The event itself comprises maybe different source events. I mean, you could click on a part of the screen to indicate that you want to press a button. But you also sometimes have a keyboard accessibility. So that means you can focus a component. And then you can maybe press the enter or spacebar key. And then also that is interpreted as, say, a click event. Both are then interpreted the same. So you can't just talk about a click event or a key press event. No, maybe there is a way to abstract from the sources of these events and then define for a button, say, a special class of events, namely, say, action events, whenever the button is pressed or whenever the button is focused and the spacebar is pressed, then an action should occur. So these components can also define their own events that could be triggered. So let me give you a more concrete example so that you can follow it a bit along. So just imagine that the box over here represents visually some kind of window on your screen. Let's say that this is a window, and the window is specifically is of class my window. It is my window. It's not someone else's or another application's window. No, let's consider that we have total control over what is shown in this window. Now, the window consists of three subcomponents. So you could imagine this to be visually some kind of button. Let's say it's of class on button. You have another button. It's the off button. And then there is a component that you can read off information. Let's say it's a light. That either the light is on or the light is off. So now consider the possible events that could be triggered and the way that these components and in their hierarchy, the on button here is a subcomponent of this window. So the window is the parent of this button, and the window is also the parent of this button, and the light, the window is also the parent of the light. And similarly, the window has a subcomponent, as children, all these three subcomponents. So now consider that we perform a user action. So like I move my mouse pointer, like I do right now, over this window. So as soon as the mouse pointer is moving within the window, every time my mouse pointer changes a single pixel, this will generate an event. So this is a lot of events that will be generated. And each of these events will be processed by the GUI application. So to be more specific, let's consider that we call such events mouse movement events, say, representing that the mouse has moved. But we can also, from the mouse movement events, understand where are these events to be delivered. Right? If I move the mouse outside of the window does not have to know whether my mouse has moved. So it does not receive any of the events. But as soon as my mouse enters the window component, then all the movements may be relevant for what the window wants to show. Eh? It has to become interactive based on my mouse movements. So each time I move my mouse while the mouse pointer is within the window component, an event is then fired. Is then triggered. Okay, so now I can also consider moving the mouse in or out of one of its subcomponents. Eh? For instance, you might want to have that if I move the mouse on top of a button, that the button lights up so that it shows that it can be pressed. Or when I move the mouse off of the button, that then this highlight disappears so that the user then knows, oh, I can no longer press that button because my mouse pointer is no longer on it. So we could distill from the movement events, say higher level events such as a mouse enter event whenever it occurs that the mouse has entered the subcomponent, or a mouse exit event. Huh? So in this case, let me explain you a little bit better what happens to these mouse movement events. Because whenever my mouse is outside of a component, it does not deliver the mouse movement event. So whenever my mouse is in the window, it starts triggering these events for the window only. But as soon as my mouse is also on a subcomponent, the window component is now responsible for passing down the events to the relevant subcomponent. So in this case, the mouse movement event is delivered to both the window and the light. And as you can understand, you can track whether a mouse has entered or left a particular region on the screen. And each time you enter a particular region, say I enter the off button region, or I leave the off button region, I can trigger an event for that. And that is the event mouse enter and exit. And also when I leave my mouse pointer out of the window, then I can have a mouse exit event on the window. And as soon as these movements are no longer tracked, because the window does not have to know about the mouse movements out of it. But as soon as it enters, then yes, a mouse enter event is then triggered. And the mouse movement events are also triggered each time I move the mouse within. So now consider that I move, for instance, my mouse on top of the on button. So my mouse pointer is on the on button, and suppose that I now click it. Then the click of the mouse button, you can understand it as I press down mouse button. This generates an event. The event is first triggered on the window, and then the window then passes it down to the subcomponent on which the mouse pointer is currently hovering. In this case, the on button. So then the mouse down event is then triggered with the on button. So visually, you could then show, for instance, the button to be pressed down. So then, say the user releases the mouse button, then the event is triggered, and that the event is triggered in the window, but the window causes that event also to be triggered on the component on which the mouse is currently hovering. So in this case, the on button. But previously the on button was pressed, and now the on button is depressed. So we can generate a mouse up event, and then that one has a special significance to a button component. Because a button component, its intention is to perform a certain action whenever you click it or whenever you press enter, whenever it's focused. The component button has its own custom event. Let's call it an action event. And this action event is now triggered by the on button. What does the action event then do? Well, in the case of the on button, whenever an action event is triggered, it will causes the state of the light to change. And so this state change itself, you can also imagine to be generated by or generating an event. When I click the on button causes the state, for instance, of the light to be changed because the light is turned on. But this state has not been visible. It's not visible yet to the screen. So the next thing what we could do is as soon as a state change event occurs, then we have to cause the area of the screen to be filled in with the proper pixel colors to represent that, for instance, the light has turned on. In this case, the light component being changed of a state causes the requests of the operating system to be drawn again on the screen, and this it does by issuing a repaint event. And next, the light then repaints itself, and it causes maybe to show a different icon that the light is on. So this is just for you to understand how these components on the screen all are put in a hierarchy, and that events are then passed along down the hierarchy until it is arrived at the proper component. And yes, everything you do on the screen and all the interactions with computers, most of the time they follow this kind of pattern, programming pattern. It's a very commonly used programming pattern whenever you deal with human-computer interaction and interactive systems. Okay, so this was the example of the component hierarchy and how events are passed up and down in the hierarchy. So, but now there was, you could ask yourself, okay, I've made a specific on button and a specific off button. And the on button, whenever it was triggering the action event, so for instance, because the user clicked on it, then it was specialized to cause, for instance, the light to go on, or to cause the state of the light to change to off. But then you need to have, for every button with a specific different action, you need to have a different component. And that might be difficult if you want to reuse components. So to make it easier to have a sort of more general components that you could reuse in different situations, there is this notion called an event listener. An event listener, you can think of as a way of components to allow external entities to register themselves to be notified whenever an event occurs at that component. And so, for instance, I could have a more general component, such as a button, and then I could register an event listener on the event whether the action happened at that button. Now, whenever the action is triggered, this triggered event causes all the associated event listeners to that component to be fired. So this basically causes a spread of the event throughout the system. But the component itself does not have to know who all registered to it. So in that sense, the component, whenever you design the component, does not need to know who is all interested in the events that occur at it. So by making use of event listeners in such a way, it is possible to decouple the handlers of events and the components where these events occur at. So then, for instance, in the case of the on button, what if we then generalize it and we just have a button, and then somewhere else we could associate and register an event listener to this general button. And then the button, whenever it is pressed, it triggers an action event, and then the action event causes all the event listeners to be fired. So then also our registered event listener is fired, and then specifically we could fit that button to a purpose, namely to cause the light to turn on. But in a different purpose, we could cause the general button to cause the light to turn off. Or in another case, we could cause the application to shut down, or whatever you want. So then we can reuse the button as a component, as a general component, in many different situations. A common choice what you could do is that you whenever you consider the class hierarchy of components, you can then think of, what do I have to do? Do I have a component that is a special subcomponent? Do I need to consider it as a subclass of an already existing component? Well, then I want to create a subclass that extends from my component, and I want to specialize it. But then the problem with this, this is the so-called inheritance way of specializing the way a component works. The way you can do that is by having a subclass overriding the event handlers for all the events that the component has. And that way you could hook in procedures for handling the events. Now, this might sound like a suitable way of dealing with it, especially if you want to build larger and larger applications with many, many different components, because you can then put them nice in a hierarchy. You could factor out common functionality between components and put them maybe in a superclass, which represents this common the common functionality of components, and then subclass it. But the problem here is what is called the fragile base class problem, is that whenever you over time want to make a modification of one of the superclasses, this causes you to revisit all the subclasses that are inheriting from the base class. And this might be fragile because that's maybe a lot of code that you now have to revisit and consider whether your change in the base class still makes sense with respect to the expected specialized behavior of the subclass. So this makes your design of a graphical user interface application fragile. Maybe before I go to the alternative is to give you an example of what is this style of specializing components. It's the button I've been talking about. Consider that this off button is inherited and therefore specializes the general button component. And the off button is specifically overriding the perform action, say, the action event handler. So whenever the button generates or triggers the action event, then the off button specializes that event handler and then, for instance, specializes it by turning off or on, in this case, off an associated light. So this off button is a subclass of the general button component. So that is a way you could do that. You could do that. An alternative would be to make use of so-called composition of components. So what you then do is you make use of these event listeners. You then have only general components available in say a library of components that you then instantiate. And for each of the components, you tweak them and you wire components together using event listeners that react then in an application-specific way to update each other's state. So then in that case, the specialization does not occur in the class hierarchy, but it really occurs on a per instance basis. Now, it is quite difficult to choose between the two. So as a general advice, you could think of yourself, before I say that, maybe an example of how to compose components. Well, this general button, say, we could instantiate, create a new button object, a component, and then register an event listener which handles the action events. So we could, instead of having an off button being a subclass of the button, we could just instantiate the button itself and then associate and register an event listener to that general button. But now, how to make a choice between this inheritance way of specializing components or by composing different components, each adapted to be fit for a particular purpose? Well, you could say, let's say you favor composition, so you favor composing component instances and then specializing them by changing, say, their properties or by registering event handlers, because then you could design a library of components that are very much reusable. An off button itself is not very much reusable because it depends directly on the light. And now if you have an application that does not have a light, but have maybe something else in which you want to show some kind of piece of information, the off button has to be changed and you have to revisit all these components. Well, if you have a couple of very general but reusable components and that you can develop in a high quality that you could even make them standardized, so that the user knows what to expect from certain components on the screen, on how to react and interact interact with those components, and how they know what the component will do whenever they interact. So that's a general design advice you could follow. Okay, so that is at least on a very high level giving you a bit of an overview of components. Let's consider a more specific example. Let's here look again at the graphical user interface shown before with the window and the buttons and the light. And so if you look at the one on the top, we have a specific My Window. This is a subclass of the general window component, you could say. And in the constructor of My Window, we could create the buttons that are the subcomponents, and then maybe make sure that the light has as an initial state off, and cause the on button to be operating with respect to the light, and the off button with respect to that light. And then, okay, that's one way you could construct this user interface. Another way to construct is to just have the general window and instantiate it, and then externally from it instantiate a button and add it to the window, and then another button, you instantiate another general button and add it to the window in a more dynamic fashion, and then you construct a light and you set its state and you add it to the window. And then you register to button B1, say, an event handler, and the event handler then causes the light that you constructed before to turn on, and you can add and you could register an event handler for the general button B2, which whenever the action is performed causes the light to be turned off. So then the question is, which of the two corresponds to which of the styles of specializing components? Well, the first one demonstrates how you could specialize components using inheritance, because there are all subclasses of the general components. And the second example shows how you can also, just by composing general components, construct the same behavior, the same graphical user interface out of it. But the latter has as a nice benefit that you can simply pull these components off the shelf. These are just general components already provided, and you just wire them together. And now if it turns out that you want to maybe use a different toolkit or a different library supplying different components, if they supply similar components, it's very easy to adapt. And so then it does not suffer from this so-called weak base class problem. Okay. And this is an ending note on graphical user interface programming, but it is a very popular design pattern, as it is called. It is the separation of so-called model components from so-called view components. So how can you understand that properly? Not every component is something that you see visually on the screen. Right? Some components represent a more abstract entity that the computer then manages in memory. An example of that would be, for instance, suppose that you have a 3D editing program and that you have multiple views on your screen that all show the same three-dimensional model, but from a different angle. If you do not separate the model component from the view component, then each of the views have their own internal representation of the 3D model that is then rendered and projected on a 2D plane. So then whenever you manipulate the 3D model through one view, how can you then cause the other view to also represent that same change? So a better way of understanding what happens here is to consider these views as being sort of windows out into a sort of abstract world. And then the abstract world is modeling some kind of entity, say a 3D model, or it could be whatever information system you have. And then the views, they are particular way of rendering or by displaying that abstract entity. And then whenever you manipulate that abstract entity through one view, then that manipulation is also visible through other views. Right? If you throw out a baseball out of one window, and it goes into the real world out of you, you can also see the same baseball through another window. And to make this intuition more clear from a design perspective, it makes a lot of sense to separate out what components are purely visual, appealing to this visual intuition that components represent this kind of space on the screen, and the components that are merely abstract or representing abstract entities, such as 3D models or artificial worlds or information systems, or these abstract entities that cannot be directly observed, but can be observed through view components. Now, as I already said, if you interact with the model through a view, through a single view, then all the other views also reflect that change. And it is now also the possibility that these views are not on your screen, but on someone else's screen. So there are complicated networks that you need to wire together to make sure that whenever your view of an abstract entity changes, that then also other views that other people on different devices, maybe on a different part of the world, are also updated to reflect the same change. And now, if you can make use of reusable components that, for instance, make this the abstract entity is synchronized all over the world, so that whenever I interact with it, everybody sees it. It is quite difficult to develop and design, develop, implement, and ensure that these components are correct. So the more we can reuse these components, the more work can be reused as well, and the higher quality the user interfaces are that you can provide then that way. And if you have reusable general components that can be easily adapted to different uses, it maybe allows you as well to have for the same amount of work, have more joy for more users. I mean, that's ultimately what we do it for, so to say. So as an example, and this is just a very simple example, but let's consider, an editor, a text editor, document editor. So you could think of the document editor to make use of this model and view separation by considering the visible components, which is the window that is visible on your screen. And then it is divided into two columns, one outline view. And you can think of that as sort of a list of, say, all the headings in the document. So it's basically showing the table of contents of the document. And then you have a rich text editor. So it's just a particular part of the screen which renders the document nicely formatted with different fonts, bold faces, italic faces, maybe different colors or whatever. And that you can then, with a cursor, you can click on a position, a caret shows, and then you can edit by typing on the keyboard, and then this updates whatever you see on the screen. Now, conceptually, you can think of the abstract entity behind these view components are the model components. And the model component is, in this case, say, a document model. And the document model itself consists then of subcomponents, say, a heading representing, say, the title of the document, and then a piece of text captured by some paragraph subcomponents, say. So now, in your rich text editor, this is a view component of this document model. And the outline view is also a view component of the same document model. So that now means that whenever in the rich text editor, through one view, you perform a manipulation of the document, say you change the name of the title of the document, you change the heading, the text that is shown, through the rich text editor, you expect then the outline that is shown next to it also to show the changes. And now think of it, how you could implement this using events. So we could think, since the model is a component, we could imagine that it also triggers events. So say that the component offers methods, because it's a class that you can allow you from a particular component to modify it. So for instance, the document model has methods which allow you to say change or retrieve whatever are its subcomponents. And then in the case of a heading method, that allows you to change the text of the heading, say. So the text editor then calls those methods and manipulates the model. But then each of these manipulations causes a particular event to be triggered within this component. And then these events that are triggered, the change events, say, are then listened to by both the outline view component and the rich text editor component. So that whenever interaction with the editor component causes a change in the document model, that this change is visually reflected both in the editor, as you would expect, but also in other components that view the same model. Okay, so but this is just superficially introducing you to these concepts. It's quite a rich field, this graphical user interface programming itself. Very interesting, very rewarding to also work with, because you can directly get feedback from what you're doing. Also very frustrating if you program it wrongly, because then your application is not really responding in a proper way. But let's keep it with this. It's quite an advanced topic itself. Let's not go deeper in this course. So this is the end of this video. In it, I introduced you to the concepts that are mainly used in graphical user interface programming. These are the concepts of events and event-based programming, components as a way of better managing event handlers by structuring components in a hierarchy, so that you have subcomponents and parents and you have this nice component tree. And I introduced you to event handlers and event listeners to decouple components where the events that happen at a component and the rest of the system that might want to react on it. And I showed to you a nice design pattern, which is the model view separation, commonly used to have multiple ways of visualizing the same abstract entity. Okay, thank you for watching this video and see you later.